Guten Abend, meine Damen und Herren, Ladies and Gentlemen. Ich werde Sie auf Englisch begrüßen, weil ja auch der Vortrag in Englisch ist. My name is Peter Schaefer, and I'm the director of the Jewish Museum Berlin. It is my privilege and pleasure to welcome you all tonight to Michael Sfard's lecture on a quite contested topic, the Jerusalem dispute, the fight for human rights in Israeli courts. The lecture is part of the program accompanying our highly successful exhibition, Welcome to Jerusalem, and is organized in cooperation with the German branch of the New Israel Fund, NIF. Michael Sfard is one of the leading human rights lawyers in Israel, and indeed, as one says in Hebrew, Shmo Holech Lefanav. His name precedes him. His grandparents were Holocaust survivors. His maternal grandfather was the famous Polish-British sociologist Zygmunt Bauman, who died last year. Both his parents emigrated to Israel from Poland after the student uprising at the University of Warsaw in 1968. They are both mathematicians, and his mother teaches at the University of Haifa. Michael Sfard studied law at the Hebrew University, Jerusalem, and international human rights law at University College London, where he earned his LLB and Master of Law degrees, respectively. He served in the Israeli army in Lebanon and in Gaza, and while serving in Gaza, he spent 3 weeks in military prison because he refused to serve as an escort for Israeli settlers in Hebron. In 2004, he opened his own law office in Tel Aviv, which has grown now from a solo practice to a firm with numerous employees. He has represented a variety of preeminent Israeli and Palestinian human rights and peace organizations, movements, and activists at the Israeli Supreme Court. In addition, he has taken up many individual cases to challenge the Israeli occupation of the Palestinian territories and represented hundreds of Israeli soldiers who have refused to serve. He has published several books and many articles, and it is his most recent book that he will present to us tonight, The Wall and the Gate, Palestine and the Legal Battle for Human Rights, published in the United States last November. There, he examines a central dilemma of human rights work worldwide, especially in the legal field, namely, the attempt to achieve justice for a client in court while at the same time recognizing, legitimizing, and even reinforcing the governing authority by doing so. Hasn't a generation of legal activists against the occupation actually served to bolster its legitimacy? Ladies and gentlemen, before I ask Michael Sfard to deliver his lecture, Dr. Susan Lurenko will say a few words of welcome on behalf of the New Israel Fund Germany. After the lecture, Sili Kugelmann, our former program director, will moderate the discussion. Thank you very much.
Good evening. My name is Susan Löwenthal-Lorenzu, and I'm here this evening to represent NIF, the New Israel Fund Germany. But I'm also here to welcome Michael Sfard, who is one of the active and, I should also add, bravest attorneys in Israel today, to work on behalf of human rights in today's Israel is a risky business. And it's only a week ago that Michael was detained along with the executive director of Breaking the Silence and the press officer of the same group, as they were in the South Hebron Hills showing a group of other Israelis what had gone on there a week earlier to some other activists working there on behalf of the human rights of Palestinians in what is actually an illegal settlement there. I represent the New Israel Fund, which is originally an American organization started in 1979 to urge Jews and other people who cared about Israel that it remain true to what its founding fathers had wanted, a state where democracy, equal rights, social justice, civic and human rights were of key importance. As you know, that is not what we see in an Israel that from which we have more and more negative news. But one very strong point about Israel is the strength of its civic society. And the New Israel Fund supports in its 39-year existence 800 organizations that have worked on behalf of those values that it and the founding fathers held dear. The New Israel Fund exists also in Germany. We started an affiliate here in 2014 in order to support the civic work of organizations in Israel. But there are also affiliates in Great Britain, Canada, Canada, Australia, Switzerland, and I think soon to be also in Austria. We work to further those values that NIF holds dear also in Germany. And we would be delighted if you would be interested in our work. There's some brochures outside, and I'd be glad to answer questions in English or German at the end of the lecture. But we are delighted to cooperate with the Jewish Museum today to welcome Michael here to tell us about his work on behalf of the human rights of Palestinians in the occupied territories and of Israelis within the borders of Israel itself. Welcome, Michael.
Well, thank you, Peter, and thank you, Susan. My job basically now is not to ruin the good name that you've created for me in front of this crowd. It's especially exciting for me to be here. I've been talking in different venues, in different cities, in different countries, but being in the Jewish Museum in Berlin is something special for me. So I thank you for your invitation, to Sinje and to Tzili and to all the staff here. And humbly, I thank all of you for coming. I can't believe how many of you came in this nice evening with such a good weather instead of being in a cafe or a bar in Berlin. Thank you very much. I was born in Jerusalem. And so going through the exhibition with the magnificent curator, Tzili Kugelman, I got an hour or so of reminding myself why I left Jerusalem. Like a good Jerusalemite, I left Jerusalem to Tel Aviv. And since about 20-something years, I'm living in Tel Aviv and working as a lawyer, as a human rights lawyer, first for a famous Israeli, renowned Israeli human rights, civil rights attorney, and then opened my own practice. As Peter mentioned, I opened my practice in 2004, but it was the summer of 2006 when an event, a meeting that I had, made me think existential thoughts about my profession. I was asked to come to meet two heads of villages, Palestinian heads of villages in the Qalqilya area. Qalqilya is a city in the center of the West Bank. These two villages have lost about 1,200 dunams of cultivated, densely cultivated olive groves to the separation barrier. The separation barrier, this huge project, the biggest national project Israel has ever materialized, a system of walls and barbed wire and patrol roads that goes along the green line, but not on the green line, the green line being the armistice lines between Israel and Jordan of 1949. Which separate Israel proper and the West Bank. This separation barrier, the route of the barrier was planned by Israel to invade the West Bank in many places and basically separate West Bank territory from West Bank territory. And so it happened that when the separation barrier was tailored, was architected, then every settlement in the West Bank wanted to be included on the west side of the barrier, on the Israeli side of the barrier. And indeed, if you look at the route of the barrier, you find out that every time it comes close to a settlement or an outpost or a group of settlements, it gets impregnated and inflated, and it becomes a bubble that captures a lot of land, much more land than the build-up areas of the settlements. So under the excuse of security, under the guise of protecting the Israelis that live in Israel and in the settlements, the separation barrier was a huge project enterprise of robbery of Palestinian land. And these two small villages in the Qalqilya area were so miserable that a few years before that, an Israeli settlement was erected next to their farmlands. And so when the architects of the separation barrier set on the maps, they've decided to take more than 1,200 dunams of their land. And when I met them at that summer of 2006 in a gas station overlooking their lands, which they could not enter, and by the way, I could have not stopped thinking of them as Moses, who can see the promised land but cannot get there. And they were looking at their lands. They have not been in their lands for 2 years. And they told me how 50% of the families in their communities lost more than 70% of their annual income because of the barrier, because it took their lands and they cannot enter in it. And I was looking at the maps and I was looking at the aerial photos that I brought with me. That's, by the way, another trait of working as a lawyer on the Palestinian issue, that your clients never come to your office. They do not have the permits to enter Israel, and I am the one who has to travel always to my clients. No client of mine has ever been to my office. No Palestinian client of mine has ever been to my office. I don't need parking area for my clients in my. So I've looked at the aerial photos, and I saw something that seemed to me bizarre. It was a younger lawyer back then. And it appeared that the distance between the last houses of the settlement, which is the subject of protection of the barrier, right, and the barrier itself was more than 2,500 meters, more than 2.5 kilometers. And I knew that in the Supreme Court, in cases challenging the route of the barrier, the army usually said back then that they need a buffer zone of 400 meters between the last houses and the fence or the wall or whatever they're creating, because this is the distance in which light weapons are effective. 400 meters, more or less, 500 meters, 300 meters. And here it was 2,500 meters. So I told those two potential client, but back then they were potential clients, look, I think this is not only legal under international law, not only land robbery, not only immoral, but I think this is illegal under the standards that the Israeli army itself presents to the court and to the public. And I was getting, you know, excited. We can go to court. We can fight this. We can argue that this is not legal according to their standards and that they should dismantle this wall. There was a curse between those words, but I will not repeat it. This wall, and if they want to rebuild it, they can rebuild it 400 meters from the last houses. And then almost all your land will be freed. They looked at this young lawyer who was very excited. They exchanged a few glances, and then one of them said, Mr. Sfard, how long will it take to litigate this case? So I said, well, if it would be really quick, 2 years. But to be honest, you should take into account 3 years. I wouldn't be surprised if it will take eventually even 4 years. They looked at each other again and then asked, well, maybe you can ask them to install a gate in the wall. And then if there is a gate, they can open up the gate for us and we can move and harvest our trees in the harvest season. And that way we can lower the damage that is caused by the fence. For me, it was like a strong hit right in the belly. I knew I can get them the gate. I knew not only that I can get them the gate, I knew that the army would be very happy to install that gate. They were building this barrier without thinking of the villagers, without paying a single thought to the people who were living of the land that they were sealing, that they were walling off. And this is exactly what they want me, the human rights lawyer, to be, the middleman. The guy that will help them make that wall, that barrier, workable. And these were the days when the barrier became a nightmare, a public relations nightmare for Israel. Because images of land, of old olive trees being uprooted and open farmland being turned upside down were shown everywhere around the world. And Israel was eager to tell the world, don't worry. We will take care of the Palestinians. We will make sure that they will be harmed as little as possible. And they needed me, not Michael Sfard, me, the human rights community, human rights lawyers, human rights activists, to help them in mitigating that photojournalistic disaster. So while going back from meeting with the villagers, I understood for the first time that when I chose my profession, when I finished high school, finished my army service, and then went to the university, and when I applied for law school, because I watched too much LA Law and all kinds of American drama, court drama series, but when I understood that what I really want to do is deal with human rights, I thought I'm doing the simple, the easy decision. Because working on human rights is easy. There are only two rules that you have to obey. You need to fight the bad guys and win for the good guys. There's not much complexity here. You always know what to do. And at that day, I realized that fighting the bad guys and doing the right thing, the good thing, helping people is not always so simple. And there are dilemmas. And from that day onward, I've told myself that I need time to take time off in order to think and theorize and think thoroughly of those dilemmas and understand them better in order to be more understanding of the effects of my actions. Am I a naive collaborator of the system? what is the right thing to do, to help the individual or to fight for a change of policy? Usually these two goals go hand in hand, but not always, not always. In this case, there was the misery of individuals that can be relieved if a gate is installed. But the long-term effects of the gate being installed and the case against the wall being weaker because of that are horrendous. How did I decide? What did I do in this case? Well, you'll have to read the book. Maybe I'll say something about that at the end. There is a presumption when I talk to you this evening that you all know what the occupation is and why I chose as a central and most important and almost exclusive, not exclusive, but almost exclusive field of work for my practice to fight it. I don't want to make that presumption. I want to say a few words about what the occupation is and why I think it is the most important moral duty of every Israeli, not only Israelis, but I'll speak about Israelis now, to fight it. An occupation is a situation that that international law defines that happens in wartime. And in wartime, many things happen in the battlefield. And one of those things that might happen in the battlefield is that one combating force, one army, finds itself, let's put it in the passive tense, finds itself controlling a territory that is outside its sovereign borders. And in that territory, there are many things. There are lands, there are natural resources, there are buildings, antiquities, and there are people, human beings, who find themselves, also in the passive tone, find themselves, those civilians find themselves under the control, under the effective control of a foreign power. And international law does not prescribe that this situation is illegal. It does not. It recognizes that that occupation is a situation that happens in wars, and it aspires to regulate occupation. And these are the laws of belligerent occupation that prescribes a kind of constitution for the occupation government. And I will not get into a whole seminar about the laws of occupation. I will only say that the main principles of the laws of occupation, which were formed partly in the beginning of the 20th century and partly after the Second World War in the famous Geneva Conventions, the main principles of this field of law are the following three. One, that an occupation is temporary. The occupation is not a permanent situation. It is temporary until a permanent status will be found, will be agreed by the parties. An occupier may not annex the occupied territory. It is not the sovereign. Sovereignty can only be gained through negotiation and consent. A derivatory principle of this is that the occupying power, this is the country that is occupying the territory, is not allowed to install long-term changes into the occupied territory. It has to maintain it in the way, in the fashion that it found it, because it's not the sovereign. It cannot make decisions that are long-term, that are for generations. And the third principle that has to be remembered, and maybe the most important one, is that the occupiers hold the occupied land in a form of trust. And the beneficiaries of the trust are the occupied people. So every decision made by an occupier must adhere to one of two considerations. It's either a decision that is taken for the benefit of the security of either the occupying power, its forces, or the territory. So security It's definitely a legitimate consideration. And the other consideration is the good, the needs of the occupied civilians. Nothing else is a legitimate decision. A decision that is supposed to advance the economy of the occupying power is illegal. Taking away natural resources from the occupied territory into the occupying state is pillage. It's a war crime. Now, at the same time that these principles govern what occupation is also the suspension of civil rights of the occupied people. The occupied people, during the duration of the occupation, do not enjoy the political civil rights each of you and also me enjoy. They do not have the right to vote or to be elected. They do not have a right to participate in the procedures that decide the norms that govern their lives. They live in a government, in a system of government that is not democratic by definition, by international law. It should be temporary, it should end, and the aspiration is that it will end. But while it is ongoing, international law allows it to be non-democratic, and so civil rights are suspended. So this is the theory. Now the practice. Israel has violated each and every one of the principles that underlie the law of occupation in numerous ways. It changed the occupied territory beyond recognition. It created settlements and colonized the territory, even though there is a specific prohibition on the transfer of civilians from the occupying state to the occupied territory. And the reason is very, very good why this prohibition is there. Because once you have civilians from the occupying nation in the occupied territory, you change the demography of the territory. You create a situation where there are two classes of people in the territory, one with all the civil rights and the other without. And that creates, of course, inherently a tendency to shift and allocate all the resources of the occupied land to the masters, to the citizens of the occupying country. And this is exactly what happened in the occupied Palestinian territory. Israel has allowed, and not just allowed, but worked very hard to have more than half a million of our citizens immigrate into the occupied territories. All those settlements, about 200 of them, more than 200 of them, are islands around which there are rings of violations of rights of Palestinian, of the neighboring Palestinian communities. Israel has introduced a dual legal system into the territory, which means that an Israeli in the West Bank is governed by different laws than a Palestinian. A Palestinian from the village of Tkoa, there is such a village in the Jordan Valley, and an Israeli from a settlement also called Tkoa, who both commit the crime of manslaughter, will be investigated by different institutions, one civilian and one military. They will be tried by different courts, one civilian and one military. They will be tried by different laws, one civilian and one military. The Israeli would face up to 20 years in prison because this is the maximum penalty in Israel for manslaughter. the Palestinian would face up to life imprisonment, because this is the maximum penalty under military law that governs his life or her life. Can you not bring into the discussion the A word? Apartheid? So as an Israeli who sees all that, am I guilty of all of that? I voted for the right, not right, correct party. I am a dissident. I do not agree with the policies of all Israeli governments who have committed all of them, all of these things. I have a friend in Bilin, a village in the West Bank. It became famous because of its struggle against the barrier, and I've been their lawyer. And one of the main figures in Bilin became a friend of mine. His name is Muhammad Khatib. He's more or less my age. He has three kids, I have two kids. We have more or less the same interests. He became a lawyer. Since I was 18, and until today, I voted 8 times for representatives in a parliament that will decide the laws that govern the life, my life and my family's life. He did not vote even once. When I come to Berlin, I wake up in the morning, I enter a cab, I go to the airport, I board a flight, and I come here. If he wants to go abroad, he needs a permit from the military commander, the Israeli military commander, who does not always provide him with that permit because he's demonstrating every other week, every other Friday in Berlin. If he wants to build a house for his family, he needs permits from planning boards in which there are no Palestinians, in most of the West Bank, not in the areas where the Palestinian Authority rules. If he wants to demonstrate, he needs a permit from the military commander. If Israeli settlers invade his land and uproot his olive trees and plant their own stuff or build there, he's dependent on Israeli policemen to investigate, to bring to justice their brethren who committed the crimes. Whatever part of usual daily life you can think of, he is governed by the people I chose for him. We, the Israelis, chose for him. That is what it means to live under occupation. You have complete and utter, you have no control completely of your life. You're not participating in the processes that govern your life. Now, if that happens for 2 months, for 3 months, that's one thing. But then when that happens for 51 years, two generations going to the third one, that's a different story. And then I ask myself back then, am I responsible for that? Am I guilty of that? I'm an Israeli. And my answer came when I read the writings of a famous American rabbi, Rabbi Joshua Heschel. And Rabbi Heschel was interviewed once about his opposition to the Vietnam War. He was famous for working arm in arm with Martin Luther King for rights of black people in the civil rights movement. But then he also was involved in the fight against the Vietnam War. And he once said, and he said in that interview, we are all responsible for this massacre that happened in Lee Mai. And the journalist asked, and we're responsible for everything that happens in Vietnam, we Americans. And he said, why do you say that? Why you're fighting against it? You're demonstrating, you're writing against it. And he said, in a free society, some are guilty, all are responsible. And for me, that was a revelation, because I then understood that while it's true that I cannot be individually blamed for things that happen that I have not participated directly in, I am part of a collective. And this collective is carrying out those things that I think of as immoral. And because this membership in that collective is very, very important, I think second only to family, the relationship between an individual, a citizen, and his or her state is the most important relationship an individual has with any collective today. The individual provides, gets from his or her country, education and health in some countries, and ability to express themselves and to participate in government and so on and so forth, and law and order. And the individual provides the collective with political capital, with economic capital, with everything that each individual has to provide, to give to the society. And this is why being part of the collective creates a moral, not legal, moral responsibility, not legal guilt, but moral responsibility. It carries a moral responsibility as long as you're part of that collective. If a country is polluting another country, the other country has a right to see everybody, all the society of the polluting country, as responsible, not only those who were polluting. Maybe there were people in the polluting country that were against creating the pollution. It doesn't matter. As a collective, they will have to compensate the victims. And the same way, it doesn't matter that I don't man the checkpoint. It doesn't matter that I don't live in settlements, and it doesn't matter, I mean, it matters. It's very important that I don't do all of these things. But it doesn't relieve me from the responsibility to do, the responsibility attached to all of this. What does it mean that I have responsibility? My answer is, since I bear this responsibility, I have a duty to resist. I have a duty to fight to end this immoral situation. And of course, here in the Jewish Museum in Berlin, I cannot but say that I don't think there is any other nation that should know better, that should know that oppressing people and discriminating against people and dispossessing people and denying them of the right of self-determination and denying them of being part of an open political society, it's immoral, it's bad, and it doesn't work. It cannot remain forever like that. So this is why, for me, I found the fight against the occupation to be the most important struggle that I can lend whatever talents that I have. And this is why I began working in this field. And while working in this field, I learned that there are dilemmas. And some of these, and one of these dilemmas I shared with you when I told you the story about this wall and the idea of a gate being installed there. But if we look at the question more broadly, we can think of two spheres of dilemmas. One is when the different goals that as a lawyer, as a human rights lawyer, as a cause lawyer, you are aspiring to achieve collide. Unlike an ordinary lawyer, I'm not an ordinary lawyer, an ordinary lawyer has only one goal, and that is to get the remedy that the client wants, according to the law, with all the legal tools they have by law, okay? That's what an ordinary lawyer is supposed to do. A lawyer that works as a cause lawyer, like human rights lawyers, they have many more goals, because it is, of course, clear that the main and most important and central goal objective of litigation is securing the remedy for your specific client to stop the uprooting of their olive grove, to have an order that allows a certain individual to be reunited with his spouse, to free a person who was is under administrative detention, which means that he's detained without any charges and without any deadline. So this is clear. To stop the army from demolishing a house of a family of a suspected of someone who's suspected of a terrorist attack, because this is, well, this is collective punishment. It's immoral under and illegal under any system of law, maybe except in the West Bank. So this is simple. This is the securing remedy for your client. But as a human rights lawyer, you're also aspiring to create, through the case that you're litigating, a policy change, a change in the practice that will affect many others in the same position as your client. To outlaw completely torture, not only to stop physical abuse of my client today, now, but to abolish torture completely, or to stop all punitive house demolitions, to declare that as an illegal act. Not only stop the demolition of the house of my client now. So this is a broader remedy that we're looking for. This is regular stuff for any cause lawyer. Any cause lawyer, it may be a human rights lawyer, a lawyer that works for defending the environment, animal rights lawyers. They are litigating individual cases in order to bring remedy to their clients, but at the same time, they are looking for test cases in order to create a policy change. In some environments, not always, in some environments, there is a third plane of objectives, not just remedy for the client and changing practice or policy, a regime change. Ask me what I do, I fight against the occupation. What does it mean to fight against the occupation? I want it to end. What, are you trying to get the court to declare that the occupation is illegal? Well, I would like to, but I'm not naive. I know that would not happen. But yes, I'm trying to contribute to the ending of the occupation. I want my cases to have an effect of shortening the shelf life of the occupation. So that's a third plane. Now, here we have already a formula with three variables, not two. And all those three variables may collide. The desire to get a remedy for the client sometimes may, if that is what the analysis brings about, make the occupation more stable, more workable. It may provide good public relations to the government of occupation. It may ease the discomfort of people who think that there is something needs to be done to stop all these bad things that happen in the West Bank, but hey, there is a court in Jerusalem and the judges are making sure that things would not go completely crazy, right? And it provides the occupation with very good messaging that Palestinians have recourse to justice, that no power is being used without reason, arbitrarily. Law provides legitimacy. And so walking through the legal paths that the abuser provides you, suggests, offers you, is a tricky thing. And so the question of whether I should resist internally, should go to court internally, and pay all these prices of public relations and of shifting energy from other types of resistance, demonstrations and others, to the court system. What is the balance between the price that a lawyer pays for going through that procedure in the abuser's court? And what is the what do you gain from it? And so in the research to my book, I tried to look at more than 40 years of litigation, 45, 46 years of litigation. There were 3-4 years at the beginning that no one thought of filing petitions against the Israeli army in the Israeli court. And it was very interesting to see, and I looked at the major legal campaigns that were waged from the 70s and until today. And it's interesting to analyze what is the record of that system. And very, very broadly, very generally, we can say that the Israeli courts have koshered and legitimized almost every practice and every policy that that the Israeli authorities have introduced, almost every. Administrative detentions, house demolitions, targeted killings, separation barrier, you name it, confiscation of lands. At the same time, thousands, probably dozens of thousands of Palestinians, individual Palestinians, got remedy through court proceedings. And one must understand the physics of what it means for a Palestinian to go to court. A Palestinian, because of all what I said before, because a Palestinian has no civil rights, they are suspended because they are not involved in government, they have no voice in electing anyone. They are nobodies. They are completely transparent. If they write a letter to the civil administration, don't be fooled. Civil administration is a military organ that runs the civil affairs of the occupied territory. It would be a miracle if they get an answer. Miracles do happen, but like miracles, they happen very rarely. But once they are lawyered up, and once they become petitioners, they are injected with matter. They are somebodies. They stop hovering transparently in the air. They become real somebodies. And then they are subject of negotiation, of discussion. And judges in the Israeli High Court of Justice very often, try to put pressure on the Israeli authorities to see what can be done. And many, many Palestinians who go into court thinking that they lost or potentially lost everything, get something through court proceedings. And that is do not belittle this. Because if someone's land was saved, or someone can go and meet their dying member of family abroad, who was not allowed to leave the country, or if someone can be reunited with his wife or her husband, that's a lot. That's a person's life saved. And so this is the oxygen that makes the system tick. If all of them would not get anything, no one would go to court. But they do get things. In what Professor David Kretschmer, one of Israel's most famous, renowned professors of constitutional and international law said, in the shadow of the court. They don't get it in court, they get it in the shadow of the court, in the foyer. And then there are exceptions to what I said before, that that policies are not, have not been, have all been koshered. Most famously, the torture case, in which the Israeli court has banned five techniques of what was called intensive interrogation techniques. A nice word for torture. But that's a major, major success of the Israeli human rights community. It took more than a decade to get that decision. During that decade, many hundreds and maybe thousands of Palestinians were tortured, suspected of security offenses. And the moment that order, that court decision was rendered, torture stopped. There's still torture in Israel, but in a much, much, much smaller scale. Nobody can belittle that result. When we talk about the separation barrier, the initial root of the separation barrier was supposed to eat up, to leave on the Israeli side, about 16% of the West Bank. That's 150 villages that are losing all their land, almost all their farmlands. That's quarter of a million Palestinians that are directly affected and more than a million that are indirectly affected. There are many things that affected the eventual route, but the major one was high court petitions and high court rulings. And while the High Court has not accepted our argument that any route that is not on the Green Line, on the armistice lines, any route that invades the West Bank is illegal because it's the de facto annexation, which is illegal under international laws of belligerent occupation. While the court did not accept that and allowed to build a wall or a barrier inside the West Bank, it had changed many of the routes profoundly. And the seam zone, the area between the Green Line and the barrier, was shrinked. It went through a diet, and now it's only 8%. So 8% were saved. 8% were united with their owners. That's a lot of families that have their livelihood saved. We cannot belittle that. So what to do? You go to court, you damn if you do, you damn if you don't. You go to court and you provide legitimacy, you provide a sense that there is wise men and women in Jerusalem that are making sure that everything's fine, when in fact the record of the court is really not that good, but it allows you to get something. And that something for a human rights lawyer is a lot, because if you cherish human rights, every person is a whole world. And so I came to grips with the fact that, for me at least, there is no more sacred thing than the individual. That I cannot, and in my book I wrote an imaginary dialogue between a potential client and a lawyer who decided that he does not want to go anymore to the court because of the impact it has on the length of the occupation, because we believe that the court in its rulings allow and stabilizes policies and practices which eventually make the occupation longer. Of course, I did not mention, but the biggest failure of the Israeli court, the one failure that can never be justified, is its failure to declare the settlement enterprise illegal. And I know that today, when we're looking at the settlement project that has more than 500,000 Israelis, it is impossible to imagine or to expect that an Israeli court would order to evacuate them all. But there were other times. There were other times when the settlement project was very small, only a few thousand people, and Israeli human rights lawyers and Palestinian human rights lawyers with Israeli citizenship have challenged the settlement policy of the government. And the court has evaded the question, claiming that this is a question that while it has a legal answer, the legal answer is that all settlements are illegal. While it has a legal answer, it should be governed by the politics because it's the main question that divides the Israeli public. That is a very bad answer because that answer says it's only Israelis that will decide on whether to settle and colonize the territory where the Palestinians live, because the Palestinians do not participate in Israeli politics. So instead of defending the rightless, weakened community that has no voice in any other place but in the court decided to empower the occupiers. So all of these things brought me to write an imaginary debate, dialogue, when an imaginary client comes to a lawyer and asks him to litigate a case for him to reunite with his wife because the Israeli authorities would not allow her in. She's in Jordan, and they would not allow her to reside with him in Nablus. And that lawyer explains that he cannot take on the case because you have to look at the bigger picture. You have to look at the general struggle to end the occupation. And when I wrote that dialogue in which the client says, but my wife, and he said, I'm sorry, I know it will be difficult for you to accept this, but I have to think of the general good of the general public. When I wrote that dialogue, it dawned on me that this is an act of sacrificing an individual on a basis of a speculative greater good that will come or will not come. And for me, that was enough in order to decide that I will do all these mathematical calculations, and I will try to see which kind of cases can both bring a remedy to my client and change policy, and if possible, also make the occupation less stable. But I cannot, even if I don't think that this is the case, I cannot not litigate cases on behalf of people who are in need of a lawyer, and that lawyer believes that there is a chance, some chance, that they could get a remedy. I also understood that when we look at this question, we have to make a distinction between winning in court and losing in court and being successful or labeling a litigation as a failure. While winning or losing is a simple thing to identify, either the court has given the remedy or not given the remedy, the fact that you won or lost in court doesn't mean that the long-term impact of the litigation is necessarily a success or a failure. There are many cases that were victorious, only to bring about a backlash that swept that victory and changed the policy to the worse. And there were many defeats, which were the milestone for an international or domestic uproar that would bring about a change later on. So when you think of going to court, I realized you don't think only of the outcome in the specific case, but you should also think of what would be the effect of that litigation on public perception, on media attention, on information that can be gained from the litigation, which is very, very important, on the long-term socio-political discourse. In many, many cases, we go knowing that we're not going to win, knowing that there is a slim chance. We want to win. If a lawyer doesn't want to win, he should lose the stop being a lawyer. We want to win and we do everything we can, but we know the chances are slim and we still go because there are so many peripheral fruits that we gain from the litigation, which help us mobilize a long-term success. And I'll end with an example to that. There was a practice that Israel has used for 3 decades against Palestinians. It was deportations. Palestinians, look, the occupation, and the control over people who are constantly without rights needs constant oppression. Because, well, people, it's a very bizarre creature, human being. They want to be free. And they don't like being controlled by others, and they try to dissent, some in peaceful means and some in violence. And oppression is a needed constant tool to maintain an occupation. And one of the tools of oppression, or not one of the tools to combat dissent and resistance, was the tool of deportations. Local leaders, national leaders, whoever was seen as becoming a community organizer was taken by an Israeli jeep and thrown to Jordan or to Lebanon. In the 70s, in the 80s, thousands of Palestinians who were leaders or emerging leaders were deported. At the beginning, it was easy. All the army needed for deportation was a signed order and a jeep to take the guy out. And then Israeli lawyers back in the 70s began challenging the deportations, arguing that it's illegal under international laws of occupation to deport people who are under occupation away from their occupied territory. And there were hundreds of cases challenging individual deportations. And there were several cases that were public interest cases in which the principal was brought. They were all defeated. Not a single deportation order was canceled by the Israeli court throughout those 3 decades. But the court did something else. The court provided gradually procedural rights to the deportees. First, to have a lawyer for a legal representation, then to have a hearing, then to get some information about what he or she are charged of, then to cross-examine the military commander or present questions, and so on and so forth. And from a process that took really several hours, the military commander decides to deport, signs a deportation order, and 2 soldiers go get the guy and deport him. It became a fiasco of months because you need to announce, you need to provide him with a lawyer, the lawyer will file an appeal, the appeal goes to the appeals committee, there's a hearing, then the appeals committee decides, then you file a high court petition. All that time the deportee is detained but not deported, and that time that is bought was the time that allowed the public to speak out, the diplomats to say their words, the media to cover it, and even in some cases the UN bodies to discuss it and to make the resolutions. It became a headache. And without one defeat, a record of complete 100% victories for the state abandoned the policy of deportations. And so, while it was all these cases were defeats, the campaign against deportations was a success. And one has to remember that. One has to remember that because we tend to look at the situation from the ground level and not from a higher resolution. And that I suggest to adopt not only when we deal with a specific practice or policy or the fight against it. But I suggest to adopt this glance, this viewpoint from high above to the whole fight against the occupation. and be aware that the question of succeeding or failing in that fight is not a sum of victories and defeats. We might be losing a lot and still going towards a huge success. And we need to remember that the way things change are not always done in a linear process where you know, you see the change coming. Sometimes the change happens in one go without us anticipating it before. Because these litigations in which we lost, these, now I'll broaden it up, not just litigations, these demonstrations that we went to, these petitions that we signed, these condemnations that were heard, it seems like they did nothing, left no mark. But in fact, they created small cracks underneath the surface. And these small cracks, one day, will join. And like a sinkhole, everything will collapse. And just like the Berlin Wall, which I understand, and I say that in other places, but here I have to be more cautious because the people who've been here, that very little number of people, if any, anticipated its fall shortly before. And just like the apartheid that fell, collapsed without even the experts on South Africa anticipating that it will happen only a few months before that. Just like the Arab Spring, that all the Arab experts, and in Israel, every second person is an Arab expert, no one anticipated the Arab Spring, and no one anticipated the first intifada or the second intifada. Huge historical events happen sometimes overnight. And I'm not suggesting to wait for that morning to come. I suggest to bring it. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that very inspiring talk. You will understand that we are not able to talk about single cases of yours, and we have to go to a more abstract political scene. If I understood your lecture right, we have to say that Israel is still in a war. You defined the occupation as a wartime situation that doesn't end. So from that, I gather that Israel defines itself in a constant war, in an eternal war until now that didn't end. Is that a right reading?
Israel is in an armed conflict that hasn't ended. Yes, absolutely. And I think Israelis or the Israeli government would say that it's in a state of emergency from the day it was established.
Yeah, and Israel, and one can hear that you didn't talk about it directly, but your analysis of your situation also underlines that Israel, in the same time, feels small and insecure, and in the same time, big and megalomaniac. So it is in respect to its firepower, to its army, to its secret service, it feels very, very strong, and it probably is. In respect to its geographical situation in the Middle East, around Arab countries, it feels tiny, and it feels very, very insecure. And Israel has, and I'm taking a little bit now the devil's advocate position.
I know him well.
Israel also has a partner, a vis-a-vis, which are the Palestinians. And for some reason, and if you look back at history, you might ask yourself, what actually, and if you think of the war in 67 and the occupation of Jerusalem and the West Bank, and the idea then, and let's pretend it wasn't a lie, which it's very difficult to define, that they needed the West Bank to hold back for a peace agreement with the Palestinian side. What happened in between is a different story. But what is the reaction of the other side? I'm not talking about the peasants you defend or the people you defend, which is very, very important, but the political powers behind that. And when the wall was built, before the wall was built, there were a lot of attacks to Jerusalem and to Tel Aviv. And the Israeli government thought by building that wall, they would prevent these attacks. And I don't think, maybe there is not even a relationship between the running down of the attacks and the wall, but there are less, if I remember, there are less attacks on Israeli civilians since the wall was built. So it is a situation. I agree totally to your reading of the legal situation, but I somehow don't see, and I do believe, I do fully believe that you can't predict history. Things are happening, and they're happening without the input of people who are trying to do something. But for some reason, I don't see a really positive future. Yes, the question will come, but I just want to round up what I think I hear. So, yes. Okay. So, and I want you to comment on that, and then everybody here in the room can say what they have to say and ask questions.
Well, I think you said several things, and I would very happily address them. Maybe the most important thing that I think you've asked me to comment on is the question of the Israeli psychic. Are we the biggest men in the room, and we're the strongest, and we're, or are we the constant victim, and we're very fearful and weak? The Israeli society was established and matured in a state of schizophrenia. There are two personalities in the Israeli psychic. And you can see that in many spheres. Israel was born in a huge national sentiment, with a nationalism and militarism. And the belief that you have to curb civil liberties for the security of the nation, and that we should be the strongest, and between being victims and victimizing others, we choose to victimize others. That's a genuine part of the Israeli soul. But there is another Israeli soul, and that is the only country that in the post-colonial era became democratic, that was established, got independence, that was based on an elected legislator, division of separation of powers, the rule of law, and basic civil liberties. This is also a genuine part of what Israeli society is about, and these two personalities have kept fighting with each other throughout the years. And if you want, we'll get to that later. In the last decade, the modus vivendi, the status quo that was created throughout the years between those two elements in the Israeli society has shattered. And what we're seeing is that the Cain in us is killing Abel in us. And that is why you can see in Israel this feeling of being the biggest and strongest, and at the same time, Israelis fear huge monsters called BDS and ICC and all kinds of things that if they would know what I know about the BDS or the ICC, they would know that they can sleep very well at night. But these are demons
These are demons that chase Israelis at night because someone is gaining political credit for that, and because this is the genuine part of the Israeli mentality. Now, as for the other issue about the wall, I have to stress, as I did in the court, the alternative for a barrier is not having a barrier. By the way, I would choose not to have a barrier at all. But that's a each person and their way they want to see the landscape. But the alternative to the barrier that we've advocated was a barrier on the Green Line. The same terrorist that cannot cross to Israel, thanks to the barrier that lies in the heart of the West Bank, would not be able to cross the barrier when it is on the Green Line. And so Tel Aviv and Jerusalem and Haifa and other places are, say, if they are safe because of the barrier, and by the way, I don't think so. The Intifada ended not because of the barrier. The barrier had some advantages, I'm sure, but that's not the reason. But the issue is using, exploiting, abusing the understandable concern and desire of Israelis for security in order to steal lands.
Yes, so now die ungeduldige Dame hier, die was sagen wollte, hat jetzt die Chance zu reden.
Secrets in
gut, dann Jasmin. Ja, hier vorne. Ja, ich hab's gesehen.
Thank you very much for your talk. I have two questions, one more practical one, and the second is a more theoretical legal one. The first one, who is paying you? I don't know if the clients you represent are in the situation that they can afford you, and I'm also not thinking that you do all the work pro bono. So so this is the first question, the practical one.
Same question my wife asks.
But maybe you have an answer for us. And the second one is a more tricky one. You mentioned the term apartheid. And I would like you maybe to explain to us a little bit more about the legal term apartheid and why you think that it applies to the situation in the occupied territories. Thank you.
So you also, Susan, before me, and she represented the New Israel Fund. And I mentioned the New Israel Fund because the New Israel Fund is one of the main reasons or one of the main entities that should get the credit for creating a vibrant civil society in Israel. There is a network of non-governmental organizations in Israel since that began being formed in the late 80s, and they basically fund most of my work. So if I have a Palestinian client, and you're right, most Palestinian, definitely the farmers, definitely the ones that live in rural areas cannot afford legal representation. Those NGOs, Israeli and sometimes Palestinian NGOs, but mainly Israeli NGOs, fund their legal defense. You don't get rich of that, but it allows many or more human rights lawyers today than ever before in Israel, thanks to those organizations. By the way, many Palestinians, I represented many Palestinians not through NGOs, and many Palestinians would not accept pro bono. They want to pay. They want to pay, I call it low bono. They want to pay something. And when I represented, for example, the people of Bil'in, they went from household to take, you know, 50 shekels, it's 10 euros, from each family in order to pay me something. So even when I represent Palestinians, many times they are trying to pay. And now to apartheid, to a different thing. When I first heard the term apartheid being used in the Israeli-Palestinian context, I resisted it very much. I was angry. I remember it was 2002. The barrier just was being erected, built, and I heard the term the apartheid wall. And I was angry because I'm a person of words. I believe in words. I appreciate words. And I don't think that people should use words lightly.
And I remember saying, not every killing is a genocide, and not every discrimination is apartheid. But I had some doubts. And so I did what a lawyer usually does. I opened the file. And I wrote on it apartheid with a question mark, and I started putting into this file documents, briefs, all kinds of things that I came across throughout my work that I thought have relevancy to apartheid. And I started learning the legal concept of apartheid. And apartheid is no longer just that experience that the humanity had in South Africa, but apartheid is an independent legal concept, which is an international crime. And apartheid is about one group discriminating institutionally and systematically another group of people in the context of domination of one group over the one group over the other, and most importantly, with an intention to maintain and perpetuate that domination. And as time passed by, the more I learned about the occupation, the more I knew the corridors of the occupation, the less I could find a good defense to say, no, it's not an apartheid. In the West Bank, I do not accept those who say that Israel itself is an apartheid state because there is an institutional discrimination against the Israeli Palestinians, the Israeli Arabs. There is a severe discrimination against them, and with the nation state law that just passed, it's even harder to say that it's not an apartheid, but I still believe that the watershed thing is the fact that they have the right to vote and to be elected, although that right is being diluted very much by the Israeli political system. And yet, it cannot be called apartheid. In the West Bank, you have two communities. You have the Jewish settlers, and you have the Palestinians. One community has all the rights. The other has none of the rights. One community is the receiver of all of the, of the, is showered with all of the resources of the territory. The other is denied development and denied all the resources of the territory. And on top of all of this, there is the dual legal system which I described. How, if you don't want to call it apartheid, you'll just be escaping the bad news.
For those of us in the audience who are not familiar with the Israeli legal system, when you present your cases to the court, what court are you talking about? What level are you going to, and how high is it? And I ask you in the context, for example, in the United States now, there is a nominee for the Supreme Court, and there's a lot of controversy about his nomination and about the future of the Supreme Court and the decisions it will make. We know in Israel that with the government of Benjamin Netanyahu, that the society and the government have leaned more and more towards the right. So one, can you give us an overview of the court system in Israel? And number two is that under the current regime in Israel, how does that impact and influence your work as a human rights lawyer today and perhaps for the future?
Thank you for this question. Israel is going through a change. I hinted to that before, when I said that one personality is about to commit a murder of the other personality. We have today a real struggle going on in Israel, a real, real struggle. I said that the status quo was shattered. I did not say that there is a new status quo instead of it. The new status quo was not formed yet. And it includes almost all level of public life in Israel. It's questions of civil rights versus the good of the nation, whatever that means. It's the questions of the power, the balance of power between judiciary and the executive and the legislator. It's about whether we are a more liberal country or a society, or a society that is very conservative, and things of that sort. And the court is one of the main main environments of that fight, just like in the States. And yes, in recent years, the Israeli right has managed to appoint many judges to the Israeli Supreme Court, changing it from one of the institutions that was considered to be the most liberal institution in the Israeli system of government. Don't be confused. The fact that I say that it's one of the most liberal doesn't mean that it is liberal. Just in the Israeli meter, it was one of the most liberal. And when it came to cases that dealt internally in Israel on LGBT rights and freedom from religion and things of that sort, it was quite progressive. And it was in the 80s, even one of the leading progressive courts in the world in LGBT rights, for example. But since then, the world moved on, and we stayed in the same place and moved backwards. And so there is a real war. And in that struggle, in this big fight, the Israeli government and the Israeli right today, the settlers, are using every incitement tool that they have against us. And they delegitimize us, all the NGOs that work for human rights and lawyers. We are being labeled as foreign agents, and we are being labeled as traitors. And abroad, they do the same. They call almost every, they label almost every criticism of Israeli policies as anti-Semitism. And you know what? It's very important for me to say it here, that it is important for people, not only those who are concerned about Palestinians and want to help to end the occupation, but also those who do that because they care about Israel and are concerned about the future of Israel, not to abide to those standards that the Israeli government is trying to inflict, that criticism of Israel, and even very harsh criticism, and even non-violent, harsh practices that are meant to put pressure on Israel, like BDS, which I do not subscribe to, but I think it is a legitimate civil act. And so labeling all of this as anti-Semitism is a crime against anti-Semitism. And it belittles the memory of those who really paid, who were murdered and were massacred because of anti-Semitism. And I know that it is very difficult, and especially in Germany. And I know that even here in the Jewish Museum, it is that you're struggling with it. But I urge you, it would not help anyone if you start censoring voices because of the fear that you'll be labeled anti-Semitic. Let's, for the sake of the fight against anti-Semitism, let's make sure that we do not fall into that trap.
Barbara? There is a mic.
As much as I respect your fight against occupation, isn't the whole question of end of occupation part of the peace solution, of peace negotiations? So can you really separate your fight from this overall question? Can you imagine an end of the occupation without the frame, peace frame?
Or to add to that, what would be the difference to annexation in a legal way?
Mm-hmm. The question was, can you separate between the fight for human rights and peace, right?
Occupation.
Reaching peace cannot happen without the end of occupation. Ending the occupation is a prerequisite to any peace agreement. There cannot be any peace when the occupation is not ending. And so while I, of course, see myself as part of the peace camp and the peace activist, it is my understanding that the fight to end the occupation and the fight for human rights is extremely important for those who want to bring on peace, because there are and there were attempts to have a peace agreement that does not secure human rights for all. And it will never work, never ever work. Any peace agreement between the Israelis and the Palestinians must be based on the idea that every single person between the Jordan River and the sea have their civil rights secured. And so these two are connected. But I think the problem is not with those who are fighting to end the occupation, that seemingly they're not aspiring for a peace agreement. I think the problem is with those who think they can bring any kind of a solution or an agreement without addressing the issue of human rights. And as for annexation, we are today in a crossroad, basically, in a very important crossroad, because this current Israeli government has made a very clever decision. It saw that Europe is very busy with the refugee crisis and with Brexit. And we saw and we know that America is completely went crazy. And so this was identified as a window of opportunity to do all the things that they would never have dared to do in the last 30 years that the Israeli right is in government. And to change the paradigm of occupation and to start annexing, really annexing, de jure, not just de facto, the territories. And we have now a tsunami of bills. Some of them already became laws that are Israeli laws that govern the West Bank, that apply to the West Bank. Israel is administratively trying to create, to transform the West Bank into another district in Israel. So we're seeing all of that. And of course, annexing the territory and becoming a one binational democratic state is the end of occupation. It's a moral solution. But there are two problems. The people in the region do not want it, almost all of them. And it seems to me, I'm not a political or a military analyst, but it seems to me that it will balkanize the territory instead of solving problems. And annexing the territories without providing civil rights to the Palestinians, that would create a de jure apartheid between the Jordan River and the sea.
Hier vorne bitte, der Herr mit der Brille.
Well, I'll try it in English. I would like to hear something about the role of international courts in all this mess.
Gotcha. Well, international courts, there are two relevant international courts. One is the International Court of Justice, the ICJ, which already had one case that dealt with the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, and that was the case in which the question of the legality of the separation barrier was dealt with, and that's a very and it concluded that the barrier is illegal and that all states must not recognize the legality of the wall, not cooperate with the Israeli work to build it, and so on and so forth. It was an advisory opinion, because the ICJ, Israel was very careful throughout the years not to provide consent to jurisdiction of international tribunals. So basically, most courts and tribunals of the international courts and tribunals do not have jurisdiction to actually issue warrants or orders that Israel has to abide to. And the same goes to the International Criminal Court, which is the second important court or relevant court to Israel. Israel has signed the Rome Statute, which created the International Criminal Court, the day the United States has signed it. That was the last day of Bill Clinton in office. And one of the first days of George Bush in office, he retreated from that signature. And the same day, Israel has retreated from its signature. So today, Israel is not a member in the International Criminal Court. Jurisdiction of the International Criminal Court is provided when the event that raises a suspicion for a war crime or a crime against humanity occurred, was committed on the in the territory of a state that is a member, or that the national suspect is a national of a state that was is a member, or if the Security Council instructs the court to deal with a certain conflict. Now, the Security Council will never instruct the International Court to deal with Israel. I'm sure you understand that and you know that. You don't have to be an expert on global politics to know that it will never happen. And Israel is not a member, so being an Israeli national does not provide jurisdiction. What happened lately was that Palestine became a state and was recognized by the General Assembly as a state. And then Palestine ratified the Rome Statute. And now the territory in which that is considered to be Palestinian territory, if an Israeli soldier or officer commits a crime there, allegedly there is a jurisdiction to the International Criminal Court. It's a very long answer, but I'm sorry. When you talk legalistic, it becomes so long. I'll end with saying that for the last 3 years, the International Criminal Court has been holding what it is calling a preliminary examination of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict in order to identify which issues should, if at all, be investigated. The Palestinians have filed many, many complaints to the court on things that happened in Gaza, on settlements, on the right of Palestinian prisoners. We'll see what the Office of the International Criminal Court's prosecutor will do with that. It is definitely something that Israelis are very much concerned about, the Israeli government is very much concerned about. But as of now, it is not something that actually affected a change in the policy of Israel. In the future, if an investigation will be launched, that could definitely have a huge effect on how Israelis see their policies.
Oops, yes. Sanya. Yes, thank you very much for what you said today, and thank you very much for what you did in the past. So I came across some years ago the village of Bilayin and was there also at a demonstration. I came to know also from Berlin here, Mohammed Khatib and also Abdallah Abu Rama, the other representative of the popular committee there, and I think you did great things there. And I've heard that Abdallah now is under the threat to be imprisoned again, and this brings me to the what you said about the individual, and I would like to combine it with Germany. I think here the German government and public could do much more in the concrete terms also to support equal rights. And maybe, and there's a bit of fear and fear in Germany to touch the subject. You can feel it at every corner. So maybe to focus on individual so-called cases that German government public says, or German government or institutions, well, we heard about this persecution of this person, or maybe you have cases where you say, yes, there the German public could, or the people that are active could do something about that. Do you see a chance there to be active?
Israeli-German relations are very sensitive. There is an inherent pathology in these relations, which we can understand. Germany's, because of that, Germany is not like any other country. Just like, as I said before, about the Jewish people. The Jewish people are not like any other people. They have experience that I believe imposes on them some duties of the lessons learned from their history. And the same goes in some crooked way for Germany. And so I think that, and because Germany is a very powerful country, and the relationship with Israel is very important to Israel, I think that the German government can do a lot more than it does today when it comes to pushing and to being a better friend of Israel. A better friend meaning to push it, not to a good friend does not always support. A good friend knows when it's time to say, you're abusing yourself, you're abusing others. No, I will not give you money to buy more drugs. No. That's kind of friend I am. And I think that the German government can be that kind of friend. And I understand that it's very delicate because, telling Israelis what is right and what is not right to do is difficult for the German government. And yet, this is something that I think all the international community has an obligation to do. And Germany has a special obligation to do, to voice the concern that this ongoing occupation for 5 decades is not acceptable, and it will never be acceptable that millions of people are not providing with their basic civil rights. This is something that is not acceptable, and the first thing to do is to say that in a way that Israelis would hear it, and not just in bilateral meetings behind closed doors. As for individual cases, of course, diplomatic intervention is one of the most powerful tools activists on the ground have. Israeli legal system is one tool. It's not always very good. It's not always receptive, and many times it does not provide the remedy we look for. But intervention, international intervention, is something that many times is like a joker card. If a certain human rights defender is defined as one, as a human rights defender, and as a political prisoner, and there are condemnations for his or her arrest, it can definitely help. And so, and again, the German, whatever the government of Germany says is heard very loudly in Israel, and recently we haven't heard much.
Well, I think we have to close down our event. It's not only not acceptable, it's not successful also. And this should be a strong argument, actually, to finish it. I want to thank you very, very much for a fantastic lecture. I think we have to invite you again. The time wasn't enough.
Thank you.
I want to put your attention to this book again. I just got it at my desk 2 days ago, and I started to read it, and I couldn't put it down. So it's really a very, very, very interesting book, and I wish everybody would buy it and read it, and then for the next discussion next year, we'll all know more about your topic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.